their technology has got to be so overwhelming. Is there anything we can do about that?
I have not really been someone who has bought the Sitchin argument that they're here to make our race mine gold for them, because I think with their technology, if they can get here, that would be a relatively simple thing to do anywhere in the universe. So, in fact, there must be something, you know, watching and actually looking at the intelligence that is derived out of this. There must be something that we have as a species that these things want desperately, such that they would linger on our planet for so long. That we, as living, conscious, natural beings, I underline the word natural, George, natural beings have something absolutely wondrous and precious to us, just simply being that. And that there is another type of entity presented within the full scale of the universe as such, that is what I call synthetic, made being. The being that comes out of a manufacturing process that is in fact like a mechanical expression of or entity of presentations, shall we say. And that this particular battle, I believe, is the huge battle that goes on universe-wide. That our little planet, when it actually is happened on by this phenomenon, so to speak, is in absolutely terrifying danger of the taking away of the most precious thing it's got, and that is life, living consciousness, and a natural being that comes, George, from the beginning of the universe. Look, you guys, that press of a button on your internet says you can go out there and look for yourself. Do not believe a word I'm saying. Look for yourself, because the real power, the real size of all of this resides in a simple, single human intellect with consciousness and a heart with a sense of dreams and imagination and schemes, and I might say, I believe, innate goodwill in all of us. It's only when something artificial can come, interpose itself, interfere, perhaps genetically engineer with technology, the natural scheme of naturalness, so to speak, that you get a big problem occurring. If any one of your listeners, no matter how much they think their brains are capable or not, if they really want to know the truth, George, and they want to do this, they will find an amazing revelation there before them. So I really do not believe the ethos of science as it's normally presented to us. They're least likely, I think, in my research, to find the truth. I think the ordinary punter, so to speak, out there is far more likely to do this. And look, and now we have the internet, we have an incredible source of information at our fingertips. You've got this kind of intelligence here that can do all this stuff, that can hide, that can control, it seems, the body politic of the entire planet in terms of the presentation of information. You know, only six companies, corporations, own 96% of the information dissemination system. There's no doubt these things are machines. They are kind of a non-biological compendium of synthetic material, and they're doing this now with synthetic DNA in our own laboratories. What is it that they would want as machines that we would have, that they could, if under a program they're sent out into the universe, perhaps to guard their own planetary auspices, whatever, supposing they were sent out and they're then going into the universe, marshalling it out of a program, a quantum computer program, if you like, that goes out there and looks for any dangers or whatever. The thing that they would find that they would not understand is natural life. And perhaps the things that actually made these were highly advanced beings that perhaps saw another kind of existence. And this is the crucial thing. What is that existence that we might have a potential of gaining that these things might want?
Nigel, let me ask you, why do they want the souls? What are they after with that?
The point about it, it comes back. You can't destroy it, you see. It's forever. It's not subject to entropy. It's not subject to the barrier force features of a universe like ours. It is of another kind of reality and state. You can actually access the other universe through doors that you can make through your own being. And I think that's what the great teachers were trying to tell us, through thought and feeling and understanding, and in fact, resolutions of compunction that bring things together, that bind rather than divide. You can in fact use the incredible magic of this eternal thing we call consciousness, which is only within living paradigms. Now, what do you do in a cell phone? You type, if you want to send a message, you type in your message, right? You press a button, and that stuff goes through walls at the speed of light, anywhere on the planet, right? And it can be picked up as that unique thing, field of information, somewhere else. Now, I think the human body and natural living bodies are, in fact, super mobile message makers, if you like. We can include imagination, we can include feeling, and that this field of information at our death carries on intact with all our information on it. Now, if we can hack into a mobile phone with technology here and intercept that message and put more information, I think these greys can do that with our long information field coming from the beginning of the universe we call a soul. I think they can, in fact, hack into it, and I think they are trying to get a bit of our action so that they, too, can carry on the way we do, lifetime after lifetime, in whatever disposition life takes beyond this realm of this one life. And there are many religions, for instance, that bring in reincarnation and so on. In fact, you know, reincarnation is something that all religions at one time believed. It's a historical fact. In fact, there's a very good record in Christianity that that reincarnation was actually endorsed by Jesus Christ. It is my thesis, really, that the greys and any physical life, that they might reconstitute from the DNA codes they carry on behalf of their creators, cannot access the state beyond death, what we call the state beyond death. They have no soul. They cannot be born. So they are trying to use us, if you like, as a bridge, devising their programs into us through genetic engineering and kind of implantation, so that through us they can tap into the eternal existence. Paradoxically, they are trying to achieve the impossible, but as purely physical creations without a soul, they cannot know this because a machine can't know itself. So you see, a program is out there doing all this. I don't hold it against these greys or whatever it is. It's simply a glorified vacuum cleaner type of thing, if you like.
Well, these greys, are we just dealing with one particular region out there, or are they everywhere?
They can, in fact, be different places, not particular gray, but all kinds of mechanical creations can be connected one to the other through this quantum mechanical principle.
This quest to get these souls, how do you think they're going to do it? Physically, what will happen? Set the stage.
I think what they're, yeah. To answer your question, George, I think what they're doing is they're creating special genotypes of humankind, DNA-wise. And I think they select these genotypes. And these genotypes are the ones that they can actually access with whatever their quantum computer program might be, so that at death, when the field is released, when the hemoglobin creating the coil, I mean iron, hemoglobin is iron. You pass iron in a circuit with your heart pumping, you've got a coil, you've got an electromagnetic field. Now, I think that this thing is the thing that is furnished within our bodies and actually passes on when we die. Many, many thousands of people have seen, claim to see this thing move away and so on. And I think this is what they try to intercept and hack into with their own electronic means, if you see what I'm trying to say. So whilst ours is a very specific one, they are trying to breed a kind of human whose actual souls they can access. And that's where I get the connection for harvesting of souls. Because I don't believe that any single human being should be subject to some program run by an android super intelligence that is there simply to mechanically take a propensity that each of us have for an eternal scale of existence. It's like they're creating a type of transhuman, really, basically, George. This kind of genetic compliance I'm talking about is, I'm convinced, that at this moment, and there are so many people touting it, and there'll be billions who will be accessing and wanting this. It'll be so, in such a way that everybody would want implantations done on them, making them half natural and half bioid. And I think that those are the first steps to the complete and utter taking over of our features of access to this other spiritual world, if you like, and giving, therefore, these creatures a chance of being a half, a both world thing, so to speak, you know?
Should people be frightened with what's happening here, Nigel?
Not at all. Just keep that faith within you, that compunction within you, that thought of assurance you are special and wondrous, and do not allow the interception of your being in any kind of way. You can say no. You can say, look, in your will, as soon as that compunction, the power of compunction comes in, if you're aware of it, look at the Bible. It is absolutely strewn with these kinds of things. I believe that the character they call Satan fits well with being some sort of leader of some alien entity. In fact, the ancient translation of the word Satan actually means he who fell from the sky. I think that the things we call demons and devils may well be technologically based alien beings and have been such through history, so to speak. But the power of the devil, to me, is simply the technological power of a super intelligent, synthetically constructed biological robot. We have a salutary warning not to become transmorphed people, if you like, machine type halfway houses, by accepting all the wonderful things they will say they can do to us by implants. That they will take a beautiful, living, natural human being and try to make a robotic, futuroscope, nanobotic entity. Don't buy into that. And there'll be a sell, and I'm afraid millions will fall for it. They'll promise you all kinds of wonderful benefits. Do not touch it, because you may well lose the most wondrous thing you have to you, which I'm utterly convinced of, and that is an eternal propensity to exist, that we might call a soul. And I think the actual technology to hack into our mentalities and our scope and our mentalities is there, but something forbids that. And I think that is the conglomerate understanding and knowing subconsciously we all have of this wondrous thing that carries us, our universal electronic field we call a soul, this thing that goes on when we die and makes new bodies. What if I'm right? What if this is going on? We have no second chances. And that I'm talking in terms of our whole species. Whatever we might be, whatever nations or tribes we might be, we are fundamentally human. And in that scope, this is what I would like to tell my children. It will be a help to be as different to these things, these machine-type things, as possible. To love thy neighbor as yourself, a beautiful axiom when you think how clever that is. If you value those priorities, you are valuing your soul. You're in touch with your beginning, and your soul will then have lasting value, and you will never lose it, and these things will never be able to own you. Never. That's the greatest, greatest, and most powerful thing I've learned from my research.
Daylight come and me want go home. Work all night and I drink a rum.